dear friends and aspirants, welcome back to my channel High Point. I hope all of you are doing great in your personal life as well as you are studying for your UGC NET JRF. So guys, we have already seen about Shakespeare's personal life as well as his literary career and his four periods of literary career. And also, like I said in that video, we'll be having a separate session, separate video about Shakespearean theater. So this is that video in which we will be discussing and learning about Shakespearean theater. So about Shakespeare, let me tell you, I have given more than five separate audio lectures in my website known as www.highpoint.in. Go and visit my website. You can see it by yourself that how much importance that I have given for Shakespeare, because Shakespeare is a huge literary giant that we cannot forget. So whenever we think about literature, we will be obviously remembering him. So not only about Shakespeare, about every other important, non-important, minor authors and works, I have given appropriate spaces in my website. So there you will find some total 900 plus audio lectures and 300 plus downloadable PDFs as well as previous and practice question papers there to attempt lively, and you can know your marks and progress there itself. So go and visit my website, and also you can join a WhatsApp group. I have given the link to join the WhatsApp group in the description box. You can click it and join the WhatsApp group. There you will find daily quizzes related to UGC NET English language and literature, as well as notes, study cards, news and updates related to NTA UGC NET English. So you can join. You are welcome to join. Click the link and join it if you want. And also you can call me, WhatsApp me, or message me in the number given in the screen. If you want to know what type of strategy you have to follow, what you have to learn, and how you have to learn, how you can build your own timetable for UGC NET, for studying for UGC NET or JRF. So you can actually have my helps. I'll be very glad to share my experiences with you if you want to know. So yeah, let's begin our discussion and learning about Shakespearean theater. Okay, so if you are sitting with a pen and paper, then that will be great. And let's begin. So Shakespeare was learning the business of drama during the last years of Marlowe's life. So see, the era was known for its literary productions in the genre of drama, right? The Elizabethan age is known for its dramatic productions and its dramatic, authors and dramatic writers, playwrights especially. So Shakespeare knew in the beginning that his career is going to be in that field. And he came to London, and when Marlowe died in a very young age, and when towards the last years of Marlowe's life, we can see Shakespeare in London, and he started to learn the business of drama. And during that time, dramatists tried to pile up as many resources as possible in their plays to attract the theater lovers. So they were taking drama contents, their stories, their elements of the drama from as many as sources as possible. So as many sources as possible, because they wanted to attract the focus of the theater lovers. So we can see that in Marlowe's case. See, Marlowe's case, we can see that his first major published work, Tamburlaine the Great, he took the plot from an ancient background. It's about an Asian emperor. So it will be fascinating to the theatre lovers in England, because the settings are far-fetched, foreign and exotic. So that will attract the theatre lovers. So in the same way, Dido, Queen of Carthage, the plot is taken from Aeneid. So, it's again mythical in nature. So, it will attract again the theatre lovers to see such settings and characters, and they are engaging in actions and all. So, even though they know many of them already know the story, but still it is fascinating to see them enacted. So, you can know Dr. Faustus. Dr. Faustus is about a man, a scholar who is practicing necromancy, and finally he arrives at his own damnation. So it was also a kind of he took this particular plot from a book. So about Dr. John Faustus, who also lived, and the book was published in German and its English translation was there, about his life and death. So, you know, it's like the dramatists were, they were always in search of resources. From there, from them, they could, you know, collect as many as stories, plots, and get inspiration to write their drama in order to attract the theatre lovers. About the year 1585, when Shakespeare arrived in London, there were three locations where plays were enacted. So, when Shakespeare arrived in London, three separate sections or three types of theatres were there in London on which plays were enacted. Okay, first one is public theatres. Of course, public theatres where public can come and all sort of people can come and pay the money and have a ticket that they can afford, and they can see the enactments, they can see the drama. Then private theatres are there. So this will be belonging to, you know, rich people like dukes or knights or such rich families. They will be having private theatres, only reserved people that they allow could come and see the theatrical performance. There it's mainly like they will have entertainments, personal or private entertainments of watching theatrical performances. And the third category is the inns of courts and halls of royal palaces. So it's sort of private theatre only, where only court people. Inns of courts and halls of royal palaces, they are also by demanding, on demand of the king or queen or any royal party or court people, the dramatic performances will be carried out. So in that way, three particular places were there on which were place were enacted: public theatres, private theatres, the inns of courts and halls of royal palaces. The drama company of Shakespeare often used the public theatres, namely the theatre, the curtain, Newington Butts and the Rose. So Shakespeare had a drama company. Often Shakespeare opted, his drama company opted to use public theatres mainly. And the theatres that they opted were the theatre, the curtain, Newington Butts, the Rose. So please remember these names, because these theatres, public theatres, are associated to Shakespearean drama company. And even though Shakespeare had shares in private theatre, Black Friars, not much used by him. You know, Shakespeare, when he began his literary career, and he was successful as a great playwright and the owner of theatrical groups and company. He became so rich, okay, so rich in the city. And Shakespeare even had shares in many private theatre, especially the private theatre known as Black Friars. The company didn't use that private theatre much, but he mainly used public theatres such as the theatre, the curtain, Newington Butts and the Rose. And Shakespeare's early home for his plays enacted in London was the Globe Theatre. So Globe Theatre is often associated to Shakespeare because most of his plays were enacted in London in Globe Theatre. So do remember that. Now, let me give some details related to the Globe Theatre. So first of all, let's discuss the shape and the way, the appearance of Globe Theatre, how it is constructed and all, the architecture of Globe Theatre. So it was circular with a ground floor and two upper galleries. So that's the fundamental structure of Globe Theatre. This theatre is like an amphitheatre. It was in circular with a ground floor and two upper galleries are there. And the stage was a flat platform and the audience sat around it on three sides. You can imagine the stage, the Globe Theatre itself is in circular shape, and you know, the stage was a flat platform and that will be projected from one side, right? And around it the audience will sit on three sides. The spot of the galleries that goes behind the stage would be occupied by the characters pouring out lofty dialogues. So, you know, galleries are there around, you know, around the stage, and galleries that goes, that part of the galleries that goes behind the stage would be occupied. So that part only in gallery that goes behind the stage that will be occupied by characters pouring out lofty dialogues. Then the stage de facto, that is the platform where the main action will take place. So there will be a stage de facto that will be projected from one side of the circular shape, right? So you can imagine that that is the stage de facto on which the main action of the play will take place. And there were no scene change by means of painting on screen. So it was like an open stage, and only the characters will, you know, come from one side, and there were no scene changes by me. So usually nowadays we can see that on the stage there will be scene settings, paintings and screen curtains will be there, background the paintings and curtains will be there. But in Globe Theatre there were no such things, no means of painting, no screens, nothing was there, no scene change. So how come the audience will know that the scene has changed? Through the dialogues of the character. So the pronouncement of the dramatist personae was instrumental in letting the audience know the exact location of the scene, whether it be is the forest of Arden or of the battlefield. Okay, so whether it is a battlefield or it is a forest or it is a palace or it is a courtroom, but now with the pronouncement of the dramatist characters, so the characters will be on the stage, so through their dialogues and all, the audience will get to know what is the setting. So where these characters are standing and they are having their actions. So their dialogues will be instrumental in letting to know the audience about the exact setting of the scene. Now, during Shakespeare's time, sports like cockfighting and bear baiting were carried on the theater. So nowadays in theaters, movie theaters are not only movies or drama will be there, but during Shakespeare's time, what was, you know, sports like cockfighting and bear baiting were also carried out in theaters. And public theaters were characterized by the mercy of daylight. That means that only daytime they could enact theatrical performances because daylight is required. There were no light tubes and bulbs that we have now, or any other artificial light settings. There were no such things. They have to depend upon candles and lantern. That will be expensive, much more expensive. So they have to, the public theater, they have to depend upon the mercy of the daylight to carry out their performances. The groundlings were accommodated in the cockpit, the circular inner area. So like I said, the theater is in circular shape. So there will be a space that is quite near to the stage. And after that, there will be seats arranged and there will be galleries and all. So the groundling means the people from very low strata of life, they could only afford a pence to see, you know, these theatrical performances. They have to stand in that cockpit. So the very, very near place to that stage, that is the inner circular area. So there the groundlings were accommodated and they have to stand. So the groundlings have to stand to watch the play despite paying one penny. So they have to pay one penny in order to have a seat there, in order to get into that theater to watch the performance. And they have to stand in that inner circular area known as cockpit in order to watch the play, even though they are paying one penny. And galleries provided seats and were more expensive. So galleries, two upper galleries were there. So in that galleries, the galleries were provided with seats and they were more expensive, obviously. And they were usually covered with the thatched roof. Okay, so these galleries, they were usually covered with thatched roof. Next comes the stage. So what are the speciality of the Shakespearean stage or Elizabethan drama stage? And it was a rectangular projection of about 42 feet width projecting into the circular area, and was surrounded on all three sides by groundlings. Now, it was like it's a rectangular shape. Even though the theater is round shaped, the stage is in a rectangular shape. It's a projection, a rectangular projection from one side of the circle, and it's about 42 feet width projecting into the circular area. So the stage, the theater will be in circular shape, and from one side of that circle, rectangular projection, that is the stage, and it was surrounded. So this stage will be surrounded by groundlings on all three sides. Okay, so groundling means people who are standing to watch the play in the inner circular area of the theater. And it was covered from above with a thatched roof and hangings. So there would be a thatched covering roof above the stage, and curtains were absent. So there were absolutely nothing to like curtains in order to drop it down and raise it up and all. And usually there was a trap door in the floor by which ghosts came up or went down. So what was the situation? How, presence of ghosts, especially in tragedies, were quite usual in dramatic performances of Elizabethan age. So usually there in the stage itself, there will be a trap. There was a trap door in the floor of the stage by which the ghost will come up or disappear or went down. Okay, so that was a stage setting for ghosts to appear and disappear. At the back, there were two projecting wings, each opening to the stage within oblique door. Oblique door means which will be not visible to the outer audience. At the back of the stage, so obviously there should be some open door to the characters to come and go, right? So there were two projecting wings like opening to the stage with an oblique door. The space between them made the inner stage. So these two, there will be some space between these stages. So mainly these two openings that will be in the two sides of the back side of the stage. So the space between these two doors, that inner space between these two doors, that will serve as the inner stage, or space between them made the inner stage. That means there the actors can take rest, or they can groom themselves, or before their performance they could sit or stand there. So in that way it will be provided with a space in the inner stage. And above this inner stage, there was an upper room meant for the actors to take rest. Okay, so there is a ghost in the play, and at times the ghost need to appear. So this person who is acting as a ghost, he can or she can go to the inner stage, and the upper room that is there in the inner stage, and he can or she can take rest there. Okay, so that was the structure of the inner stage. And lighting was provided by lanterns and candles. Even though the performances were mostly carried out in the during the daytime, lighting must be there, and it was provided by lanterns and candles. And music was provided by means of trumpets and wind instruments. So usually trumpets and wind instruments were used in order to provide music during the actions going on in the drama, during the enactment was going on, to provide some impacts. And males played the part of females, and tragedies were enacted under the roof of the stage, hung with the black sheets made of cotton. So usually during the time of Elizabethan drama, female actors were not there. So the female parts were played by male actors who were groomed, or who were dressed like females, and males only played the female characters. And tragedies were enacted under the roof of the stage, hung with black sheets made of cotton. So there will be a black sheet hung from the roof before or above the stage that indicates that what? This play is going to be a tragedy. And each performance, so at its end, the actors kneeling on stage praying for the welfare of the queen. So, towards the end of the performance or after the end of the performance, every other characters will come to the stage and they will kneel on the stage praying for the welfare of the queen, Queen Elizabeth. And the stage provided opportunities for the audience to come into contact with the actors. So it's like kneeling on the stage and praying for the welfare of the queen. It's like we sing national anthem before and after the performance or any other event that we are carrying out. So it's like that during that time. And the stage provided opportunities for the audience to come into contact with the actors. Since the stage had no curtains or nothing to separate, just an elevated position. Other than that, no curtains and all there to separate the audience from the stage. So especially the groundlings, they will get an opportunity to come into contact with the actors. Even the actors concerned were carried away or walked off the stage. Actors concerned means, see, if a person got killed, so suppose the battlefield is going on and some persons are killed and maybe the eminent characters are killed, then what will happen? Such persons will be carried away or they have to walked off. So a dead person cannot be walked off, so they need to be such people, those who are killed, they need to be carried away, or other persons will be, as the scene changes, they will walk off the stage. So Shakespeare's audience passively accepted distant places on the stage. So Shakespeare, see, suppose we can see that in Macbeth, he showed Scotland. In Hamlet, he showed Denmark. In Antony and Cleopatra, he showed the exotic setting of Egypt. So Shakespeare's audience is not only for Shakespearean drama, but the audience of that time, they passively accepted distant places, exotic places or foreign lands. Okay, so it's like it was not a problem. So that actually breaks unity of place, right? But still, that's the enormous capacity of the audience that they could accept. If a dramatic action shows a distant place happening, a very unfamiliar characters and unfamiliar settings, even then the audience will passively accept it. Now also it is like that. Whenever we see something on the stage and they announce that this is the place and this is a forest that is there in a place known as China, then that will be accepted by the audience. So during that time also, Shakespeare's audience also passively accepted distant places on the stage. That generally never affected the grasp of the audience about the action and storyline or plot of the drama. So the next point is that a trumpet blast started the performance. So with a trumpet blast, the performance, the theatrical performance started, and then came the prologue. So once the trumpet blast occurred, then a prologue will be followed, spoken by an actor in a black long coat. Okay, so the prologue will be delivered by a particular actor, and the actor will be wearing, or actor must be wearing, long black coat. The giving of a tragedy was signaled by draping the stage with black for a comedy. Blue hangings were substituted. So tragedy and comedy were signaled by hanging clothes above the stage. Like I said, for tragedy, they will hang a black cloth of cotton above the stage. The same way for comedy, blue hangings were substituted. So if the drama is going to be a comedy, then blue hangings were there above the stage. And for tragedy, black clothes will be hanged above the stage. And to keep up the spirits of the audience, there was a gesture to dance between the acts. So it was not like, continuously scene after scene, these actors will be playing. Maybe just after tragedies, just after the climax, What will happen? There will be adjusted to dance between the acts in order to keep up the spirit of the audience, in order to heighten the impact of the action, or in order to, you know, get mainly to get the characters to change their costumes, to you know, have them relaxed a moment. So in that way, for many other reasons, there will be gestures to dance between the acts. So that was also common there in the Shakespearean theatre or Elizabethan theatre in common. Now, so that's all about the structure of stages and Elizabethan common practices in their theatre. Now, let's see Shakespearean comedy, tragedy, Roman plays, problem plays, such categories related to Shakespearean drama. Okay. Shakespearean comedy. First of all, let's see some characteristics of Shakespearean comedy. I just briefed down some points, because it will be, you know, too long. This will be a very lengthy video if I go on telling about Shakespearean comedy only. So you can go and check my website. You will find there enormous amount of details related to Shakespearean comedy and Shakespearean tragedy. Separately, I have given two audio classes for that. And also, don't forget to join the WhatsApp group. There will get study cards, materials, and also encouragements, and also you can have a chat with me, and also you will get news and updates and daily quizzes related to NTA UGC NET. So don't forget to subscribe to my channel, as well as join the WhatsApp group. Okay. So Shakespearean comedy. Shakespearean comedies are usually romantic comedies. They are romantic comedies, so usually love will be the theme. And lovers usually experience a set of obstacles before they get united in a harmonious union. So obviously in romantic comedies, it's like that, right? Even in films, we all know that lovers will be there, and or two people will fall in love, and couples will be there, and they will experience a set of obstacles, a set of problems and issues before they get united in a harmonious union. And all conflicts were resolved at the end, and a comedy usually ends with a marriage or a celebration. So Shakespearean comedy, especially in films also, we can see in romantic films, and especially in Shakespearean comedy, that, you know, there will be conflicts and obstacles before their union, but all these conflicts and obstacles were resolved at the end, and a comedy usually ends with a marriage of the couple. And romantic comedy of Shakespeare usually set in an imaginative world far away from the dull and dreary world of everyday life. So there will be some resemblance with the usual way of life, but it will be set in an imaginative world far away, imaginative human world only. So it will be set in an imaginative world which will be far away from the dull and dreary world of everyday life. And his mature comedies also present a philosophical insight. So initial romantic comedies were just romantic comedies, nothing philosophical, nothing deep. We won't find anything like that in Shakespearean initial romantic comedies, but his mature comedies also present some philosophical insights into various things. So some comedies are The Merchant of Venice, Taming of the Shrew. So Taming of the Shrew, even though it raised many feministic criticism and all, but still they are just you know, like comedies, nothing more is there. And Twelfth Night, Much Ado About Nothing, The Two Gentlemen of Verona, As You Like It, Measure for Measure, The Tempest. So Measure for Measure and Tempest, they were usually, they also categorize it as tragic comedy, as well as problem plays that we will see later. So these are some examples for Shakespearean comedies. The next one is Shakespearean tragedy. According to A.C. Bradley, a Shakespearean tragedy can be divided into three parts. So Shakespearean tragedy was studied later in the coming generations, and A.C. Bradley, he is one of the greatest Shakespearean critic, and he said that a Shakespearean tragedy can be divided into three parts. There will be an exposition of the stage affair, that means an introduction. Exposition means the beginning of the play, in which major characters will be introduced and major theme, in a way there will be a hint to the major theme, and also what is going to happen to the major characters will be also somewhat hinted in the exposition. And exposition, nothing but the beginning of the story, and the beginning growth and vicissitude of the conflict. So after this exposition, there will be a conflict that will be slowly starting, and the conflict will be growing, and you know, finally it will reach to a climax. So in Macbeth, we can see that in the initial part itself, the three witches are there and they are meeting Macbeth and Banquo, and two their fate is revealed there, and also their attitude towards the prophecy is also revealed. And you know, Macbeth is carried out by the ambition to have power, and he does everything, and this conflict arises and it reaches to a climax in which he kills King Duncan. So it actually, this conflict reaches to a, you know, it actually entangles as the rising action happens, and this will be ended with a climax. And the final catastrophe or tragic outcome, that is the third part. So after this climax, what will happen? There will be an unraveling of actions, and the conflict will be, you know, that conflict, that climax will lead to the tragic outcome or catastrophe, or, you know, the tragic end of the hero. So that is the usual, these three things are the major three parts of Shakespearean tragedy. And the tragedy ends with the death of the tragic hero. So not only the death of tragic hero, but probably all the major characters will be dead towards the end of the Shakespearean tragedy. And his tragedies developed out of early 16th century tragedies. So his tragedies were much influenced by Marlowe, and also 16th century tragedies, early 16th century tragedies, and also he was influenced by Seneca. Seneca is a Roman playwright. And his revenge tragedies were also a great influence on Shakespearean tragedies, especially upon Hamlet. So his Romeo and Juliet, Macbeth, King Lear, Hamlet, Othello, Julius Caesar, Antony and Cleopatra, Cymbeline. So these are major tragedies by Shakespeare. And Shakespearean history plays. So actually, when Shakespeare was composing these plays, he never divided his plays in this way. But later, the critics made such divisions by analyzing his plays and characters, characteristics of those plays. So after comedy and tragedy, we have history plays. The term generally refer to the 10 plays that cover English history from the 12th century to 16th centuries, and each named after and focusing on a reigning monarch. So we can see the Shakespearean history plays, they were mainly from the 12th century to 16th century. So he took a reigning monarch, so he mainly focused upon the monarch of the time, and he wrote the actions or the history plays or the story or plot of the play around that monarch. Okay, we can see that only his history plays were named after whom? Named after the monarch, nothing else. And his primary source of the history plays were Raphael Holinshed's Chronicles of England, Scotland and Ireland. So this particular work by Holinshed stood as the source, or that was the main source for the history plays by Shakespeare. What was the work? Raphael Holinshed's Chronicles of England, Scotland and Ireland. Usually have episodic plots. So his history plays, usually they had episodic plays, like, you know, Henry the Sixth, Part 1, Part 2, Part 3. Henry, you know, Henry the Fourth, Part 1 and Part 2. So in that way, usually historic plays were having episodic plots, and they have politics as well as the personal bias of the playwright. So we can see that in every other history place, he was not at all telling only the things, only the actions, only the story that he found in the source books, but he also indulged some, or he also introduced some personal bias and into the play, and the current politics into the play as well. So they had story plays were having episodic plots, and as well as the playwright also induced or also mixed the contemporary politics as well as his personal bias into it. And we can see a combination of both tragic and comic elements in these history plays. We cannot categorize them individually or specifically them into tragic or comic, but still both tragic and comic elements are visible in history plays. So plays like King John, Richard II, Edward III, Henry IV, Part 1 and 2, Henry V, Henry VI, Part 1, 2, 3, Henry VIII and Richard III. So Richard III is a tragedy. So in that way, these are some of his major history plays. Now, let's see another category of Shakespearean drama, Roman plays. So Roman plays, from this name, term, Roman plays itself, you can find what does it mean. Like, all these plays are set in Rome and it deals with similar subjects and make use of the same source, that is North's translation of Plutarch's Lives. So all these Roman plays, they are similar in subject. They mainly talk about Roman Roman people, Roman politicians or Roman emperors and all. And Shakespeare composed these Roman plays. He depended upon the same source known as North's translation of Plutarch's Lives. So Plutarch has came up with a work known as Lives, and it got an English translation by North. So that book served as the major source for all of Shakespeare's Roman plays. Okay. And he developed his idea of Roman character and elaborate on him at both national and individual level. So he takes a Roman character, okay? He developed his idea upon that Roman character and he elaborated it. And, he elaborated the Roman character in such a way as a national as well as individual figure, okay? Usually, blood, violence and mayhem, these are important features of Shakespearean Roman plays. So, mostly they are of tragedies. Blood, violence, death, ghost. So, these are treachery, tricks. All these are very important features of Shakespearean Roman plays. And suicide is an inevitable element in all of them. Suicide is an inevitable element in any, some of the characters, they will be doing suicide in Shakespearean Roman plays. And Roman plays also depicts the Romans as self-conscious, theatrical and historically aware characters. So Shakespeare always portrayed Roman characters as self-conscious. They were thinking too much about themselves and they are brooding over, and also they are theatrical, dramatic in their actions and also historically aware characters. So examples of Roman plays are Julius Caesar, Antony and Cleopatra and Coriolanus. So these three are inevitably, they are tragedies, okay? Now let's see Shakespearean problem plays. So these plays of Shakespeare do not neatly fit into any of these categories. So even though some of them are, we can say some of them are comedies, but they have tragic elements as well. But these plays, these problem plays, they never fit neatly, very clearly, without any doubt, fit into any of these categories, or they are not purely comedies, they are not purely tragedy, they are not purely historical plays or drama, dramatic composition of Shakespeare as historical plays. So, critic Frederick Boas, he is the one who first used the term for some of Shakespearean plays in 1896. So, Frederick Boas is also a great Shakespearean critic, and in the year 1896, Boas is the one who first used the term problem plays for some of the plays by Shakespeare. And they were distinguished from others by its tragic ending. Even though they are comic in nature, but they have tragic ending. But even, even they have a comic ending, all the events happening inside the play are tragic. So in that way, they were not neatly, we cannot call them purely as comedies or tragedies. So such problem plays by Shakespeare are All's Well That Ends Well, Measure for Measure, Antrobilus and Crusader. And all three of these plays were written between 1599 and 1605. So that is another characteristic of Shakespearean problem plays, such as all these three plays were written between 1599 and 1605. Let's see. Now we have Shakespeare's tragic comedies. Tragic comedies are specially mentioned by Shakespeare that he combined tragedies and comic elements together in one play, and he violated the unity of action and every other unity's possibility. And also his dramatic composition as tragic comedies, they also faced many criticism from the critic that came after Shakespeare's age. So comedies with a tragic resonance are usually known as tragic comedies. So you know, it's like many tragic elements will be happening throughout the play. And after the second or after the first half of the play, in the second half of the play, what will happen? Every other tragic elements, tragic problems and issues, that will be resolved very quickly. So it is quite unusual, but still, you know, our life is like that, right? We will be having both tragic and comic elements at times, right? So it's like that, comedies with tragic resonance, but the end will be always comic in nature. There will be celebration, marriages, and all the conflicts will get resolved. But especially the comic things happening, or all these resolvements, all these final resolutions will be in the second half of the play, you know, in which every other tragic elements will be turned into comic ones. Okay, and in the end, every conflict will be resolved. So plays like The Tempest, Twelfth Night, Measure for Measure, these are the some of the major tragic comedies by Shakespeare. Now, so that's all about Shakespearean theatre or Elizabethan theatre as such. And also we have discussed Shakespearean comedy, features of Shakespearean comedy, tragedy, Roman plays, history plays, problem plays, and tragic comedies. So I hope that was clear enough. So if you have any doubts, questions, queries, do mention that in the comment section, and also go and visit my website www.highpoint.in, and also don't forget to join the WhatsApp group. Click the link and join, and also call the number given in the screen, or can message me on WhatsApp me to know more about UGC NET English language and literature, to have help from me if you want to have. Obviously, if you want to know what type of strategy I have to use, or how I can form a timetable of myself in order to have a systematic study for UGC NET JRF, or what you have to study, or how you have to study, and what is the most important topic, and how you should categorize the topics that you have to study. So in immense ways I can help with my experience and help with my research that I have done in this area. And also you can mail me in the given mail ID. And also thank you for watching this video. If you have not yet subscribed to my channel, please subscribe to my channel and also press the like button if you like the content of the video, and also share this with your friends and family, those who are needed. Okay, bye bye. Thank you. That's all. Let me meet you in the next video.